And let's tackle this issue now with Professor Renato De Castro of De La Salle University's Department of International Studies. Professor, good afternoon to you. Welcome to the program, and thanks for joining us today.
Good morning. Good afternoon, Carmina. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. And yourself?
I'm doing well. Doing well, yeah.
All right. Another day, another attempt to fabricate and claim and overreach its territories being made by China. Let me begin with a statement coming from China's spokesperson Wang Wenbin. He said that the Ministry of Natural Resources of China released a 2023 edition of the standard map. It is a routine practice in China's exercise of sovereignty in accordance with the law. And he ends the statement by saying, "We hope relevant sides can stay objective and calm and refrain from overinterpreting the issue." Professor, overinterpreting this claim and the appeal to remain calm, or what are your thoughts?
Well, again, it's a Chinese approach. Basically, they'll do something aggressive, coercive, and they expect countries not to react. That's a Chinese approach. You know, we can do everything necessary. We can do unilateral actions, but you cannot react. So it reflects what I basically call the Middle Kingdom mentality of China. China is entitled to do everything. Countries have no rights, basically, to react on this. You just have to accept it as it is, because that unilateral action is coming from the Middle Kingdom. This is how China views the world, what they call the Middle Kingdom mentality.
Mm. But you have now Malaysia and also the Philippines. Let me go to Malaysia first, rejecting that claim of China, which now appears to be a 10-dash line from the 9-dash line. It's now increased to 10. Malaysia rejecting that, the Philippines as well rejecting the claim of China. How do you then, aside from all these individual rejections of this latest attempt by China, how do you then move a step forward and make these claims totally irrelevant?
No, number one, we have to understand the context. You know, Foreign Minister Wang Yi was just in Malaysia early this month, you know, trying to basically assure that China-ASEAN relation is well. And you also have to take into account, ASEAN is negotiating with China regarding, you know, the code of conduct. Then suddenly China would come out with a statement that, you know, it basically claims the entire South China Sea, including Taiwan, and more significantly also the Taiwan Straits. And what we have also did not discuss is India's reaction to this incident. China also claims the entire Indian province of Arunachal Pradesh, then also claiming territories it was able to take control during that October 1962 mm-hmm. border clash with India, Aksinsai. So again, this also angered India. Interestingly, just a couple of days ago, you have Prime Minister Modi and of course President Xi Jinping meeting in South Africa, and Xi Jinping basically told, you know, Prime Minister Modi, you know, we have to resolve this issue right away. Mm. Then suddenly China would come out with this very offensive map. Mm. You know, how do we basically would have to, you know, respect or take into account Chinese actions and words? China would say one thing and do another. Mm. You know, basically assuring countries in the region that China is a stabilizing force in the region. China would like to resolve everything on the basis of diplomacy. Win-win situation, then suddenly China will come out with this unilateral action.
So once again, the duality on display.
Yes, obviously. You know, China would say one thing and do another. Mm. People would say, you know, this is basically a reflection of bureaucracies in China not coordinating with one another. That's basically hogwash. Mm. We have to remember every action by government bureaucracies, the military, the Coast Guard, and even, of course, the maritime militia are, of course, directed by the Communist Party.
Yeah, make no mistake about it. Every single action has been deliberate when it comes to China.
Yeah, of course, guided by the Communist Party.
Exactly. But how do you now make it irrelevant? I mean, you have the rest of the world looking at this. you have individual rejections. Is it about time that all these countries who have rejected these claims band together and do what? Put out a statement? What action are you expecting from these countries, including the Philippines? Go ahead.
Well, of course, in case of the Philippines, we have to again reassert our claim. The Department of Foreign Affairs has rejected that map, which is well and good. You know, in a matter of less than one day, the Department of Foreign Affairs was able to come out with a statement reflecting our position. It's probably high time also for us to really take seriously our efforts to strengthen our maritime capabilities. Both the Coast Guard and, of course, the Navy. And probably it's also time for the maritime Southeast Asian countries to resolve their overlap claims and talk about, of course, developing coordinated action that would, of course, prevent China from initiating any unilateral actions that have to do with its maritime expansion and efforts, of course, to coerce countries that are resisting China's maritime expansion, not only in the South China Sea, but even in South Asia and other parts of, you know, where China shares a common border. I think it even claimed an entire island in the Amur River, which, of course, the Soviet Union and China were able to resolve in the 1980s, an island. But in the map, you know, during the time of Gorbachev, during the time of the Soviet Union, they decided that they would have to divide that island, that very small island in the Amur River basin. Now, the map also indicates that China owns the entire island. And Russia, of course, has not yet reacted. So, you know, again, this is a reflection of how aggressive China is when it comes to its maritime claims. Yeah. Not only maritime claims, territorial claims.
Yeah, so you're saying it's about time for these countries to band together, maritime countries and countries that share a border with China. But here's where things get complicated, Professor DeCastro. They also have trading ties with China. So if it's a matter of banding together and now coming out with a stronger rejection, having a maritime exercises as well, who's going to go first? I think that's what they're protective of as well, these trading ties that they share with China.
So it's probably time that we have to slowly diversify our trade relation away from China towards other countries. That's basically being done now by the Western countries, Australia, the United States, Canada, the European Union, after, of course, they realize how China uses economic interdependence to use what is called sharp power. Australia has become very much aware of this. So the policy now is slowly de-risking your exposure, your link, your interdependence with China. Because countries are also realizing how China is using economic interdependence as a leverage against countries that, of course, have territorial disputes with China.
Aside from that, do you think that it's also imperative, or will it actually be useful if the Philippines also come out with its own map, delineating as well what is ours?
Well, I think what is crucial is we first pass the baseline law that is still pending in Congress. So before we could come out with map, we have to delineate what our baseline, what is basically our exclusive economic zone. We haven't passed any law that could be the basis of that map.
Why do you think that's?
We cannot just come out with map unless, of course, it's based on a legislation.
Yeah. Why do you think that's taking quite a while to be passed?
I don't know. We have to ask our individual congressman and senator. Why are you delaying those? The most basic, of course, the baseline law.
All right. What are your expectations now that China has come out with this map, rejections coming in as well? How do you think this story is going to play out in the next news cycle?
We expect, of course, from Chinese perspective, no matter the outcry that's been generated by its action, China is showing its determination. You know, China, of course, has this determination because from their perspective, China now has developed its comprehensive power. It has, of course, it's the largest, the most important trading partner for a number of countries. China, of course, has now the largest navy in the world, in terms of numbers. And of course, there is a growing sense of nationalism in China. That's high time for China to basically find its place in the sun. At, of course, the expense of countries like the Philippines, Malaysia, India, Vietnam, and Indonesia. And of course, the self-governing island of Taiwan. Mm.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. We've run out of time. Professor Renato De Castro, right there, sharing his insights with us this afternoon. Professor Renato De Castro is, of course, a distinguished professor of international studies there at the De La Salle University. Thank you so much, and nice to see you
again,
Professor.
Thank you very much, Carmina.
Take care.
Okay.